Good morning. We're going to hit on a couple of good key points here about crucible melting. Maybe you'll have a little bit of enlightenment on an opportunity that may present itself in your facility for crucible melting. Once you see what we do and once you see the benefits and the limitations, we'll go through some changes to equipment and changes to crucibles that have been occurring to make them even more efficient in today's economy. A lot of the furnace technology that you've seen so far has been new technology. Crucibles have been around a long time. Some of the crucibles that we sell today were still made back 100 years ago the same way, just different binders and different chemicals in them. Electricity melting is about a 60-year-old technology. Certainly it's advanced over the years. Melting efficiencies, as you've seen from some of the other types of furnaces, have greatly improved over the decades, and we want to continue to improve that through driving improvements in the technology, especially in the crucible. Okay, we're a crucible manufacturer. The crucibles fit furnaces, as you can see, that are made by many manufacturers and homemade furnaces. So you've got to make a crucible that's pretty versatile. A reference point that we'll use in some of the data that you'll see later is 503 BTUs per pound. If you're looking to convert kilowatts to BTUs, it's 3413. So here's a guy's back in the Stone Age, melting with the oldest versions of crucibles that have been found back in the Middle East area. And you can see there's no containment of the energy source here like there are in the newer furnaces. So those guys, no gloves, no nothing. Now, we're stepping forward in time several hundred years, but unfortunately those kind of furnaces are still around. You've got very crude lining, some of it not sealed, and you've got minimal insulation so that you can't get anywhere within 4 feet of that furnace shell or you start to burn your clothes. This dirt mound is probably in the range of about 6 foot in diameter, and at the highest point in the back is about 4 to 4.5 feet. Enclosing a burner combustion area and a crucible. No shell, no insulation, just dirt. That furnace is still in use. A lot of old furnaces, a lot of newer furnaces that are still running, the inside of the furnace, as you can see, has a very rough, crude refractory lining installed, and the flame is not smooth, the flame is not single direction and controlled. It bounces all over the place inside the furnace, but it still runs, it still heats the crucible, and it still melts the metal. It's just not efficient. Where are we going? Where have we been here recently? What are we providing to the industry as far as alternatives for crucibles? Various different kinds of furnace arrangements use crucibles. It's not just a dip-out furnace. It's not just a tilt furnace. It's not just a stack melter, as we'll see here. Capacity ranges. Crucible furnaces now, there are some crucible furnaces that hold 5,500 pounds of aluminum. Multiple energy sources. We talked about the ideal situation would be to have multiple energy furnaces. There are multiple energy crucible furnaces that some of the manufacturers make. An increase in energy efficiency. Mostly all of the furnaces that are made by the different manufacturers today are much higher energy efficiency than they were even, 25 years ago. And the work environments have changed. They're much more safe, much quieter, much cooler. And we tend to think that from the crucible side of the business that melting in the crucible and melting in an arrangement that keeps the heat source away from the metal, that provides you with the lowest melt loss rate. So we have different kinds here. As we said, you can see in the top picture there you have a furnace bank lined up. Those furnaces could all have different alloys depending on what's coming down the mold line for the man to dip out of. And he could just easily enough change out his ladle and pour from one of the furnaces into whatever mold he's got. We've got lift-out furnaces where the crucible comes out and the metal is taken to the mold. We've got tilting furnaces that pour into transfer ladles. We've got heated electric ladles, as you heard from Apogee earlier. Tilt furnaces to fill those ladles and then taking that ladle to the mold. And you've got crucible-type stack melters, as David talked about this morning. So all those hold crucibles. Well, you've got various alternatives to give you the process optimization that you're looking for. Why use crucible melting energy again? Multiple energy sources, natural gas, electricity, resistance, glow bars, induction furnaces, different fuel sources, Couple furnaces running on biofuel now, and dual energy furnaces, a furnace that can heat on gas or heat on electric, hold on gas, hold on electric, heat on propane, heat on natural gas, they're available. A furnace that holds 2,000 pounds of metal typically is less than 36 square feet of plant floor space. That's important in today's plants where you just don't want furnaces taking up the whole floor. You want compact. And those furnaces can be very close to the mold. Again, multiple alloys, even in the same crucible furnaces, you can run one or the other. So you know your limits as casting producers and metallurgists of what alloy variations you can do. But to change out a crucible furnace is minutes. And with the crucible furnace, if you're melting and processing in batches, you can keep batch integrity. But furnaces in casting cells, this one happens to be a hot charge furnace, a gas-fired furnace. Put it right next to the casting machine. This one happens to be in a die cast plant, but it could just as easily be a mold line going right past the furnace with a ladler. You can have robotic pour, robotic bottom pour. You can refill on the fly. Some of the crucibles have baffles that separate the fill side from the dip side to keep the dip side cleaner. You can add an ingot charger if you want to a casting cell. You can add a scrap recharging. Here's the baffle in the crucible. The crucibles can be made with a baffle put into them, or they can have a replaceable baffle. There's all kinds of flexibility and creativity that you can get with a furnace. In most of the newer furnaces, we try and encourage the customer to arrange the furnace so that the metal and the combustion area are separate, so that the crucible top is sealed from electric heat source or gas or fuel or whatever heat source. Indirect heating, radiant heating, again, equals the lowest loss rate in the metal that we can get out of crucible. And the alloy and consistency of the alloy stay pretty high in the crucible furnace. About 30, 40 years ago, you'd find that there was some experimenting going on with recuperation, and you can see that the older style burner systems here that had a separate high velocity fan were blowing air in through a recuperator and then down into the blower, into the burner block, and then out into the crucible. These still had some advantages over the non-recuperative type furnaces, but they're not as energy efficient as you'll see in today's furnaces. So they were the first generation. Recuperation is taking the heat that's caused by the combustion, using that heat to preheat the air that's going into the burner, so that you don't have to spend the BTUs of energy to heat the air going into the burner. So you spend less BTUs per pound of metal melted. The newer furnaces that are made today have taken advantage of a lot of the insulation materials that have been developed in the last couple of decades. Very high alumina content, very good energy efficiency, very good thermal protection and non-wetting properties of some of the refractory materials, so that you get good energy efficiency and good clean metal all at the same time. The heating sources, if you have an electric resistant type furnace, you'll see there's developments in the electric heating elements. More alumina going into those elements, and they last quite a long time and they're very energy efficient. So if you can keep that heat in as much as possible around the crucible, then you have a higher efficiency crucible furnace. The element wire that's used in those heating elements has been upgraded. It's a little bit more expensive wire, but it lasts a lot longer and it provides more thermal energy conductivity. And some of the elements that are out today are able to go at higher temperatures so that you don't have element failure, so that the element lasts longer and produces a better, faster melt. One of the downsides of electric melting in crucibles, it's slower than gas-fired melting. If you were to look inside of a crucible furnace that didn't have a crucible in it and you saw the flame coming in, you're going to find it mostly coming in at the bottom, tangentially to the crucible, working its way around the furnace as it goes up, and then coming out the stack. Some of the burners that are coming out now, the burner manufacturers are working with lower speed burners, as Martin talked about earlier, working with variable speed burners instead of single speed burners, to give you the heat input that you need, and only the heat input you need. You can run a crucible furnace for a couple of hours with the lid closed. It won't lose any temperature because the chamber has been heat soaked. The new recuperator systems that are coming out from some of the burner manufacturers are taking even more of the waste heat and using it so that you're capturing more. The number is up to about 25% change in the efficiency rate. And there's some development going on to get those recuperators even smaller. So again, we're trying to maximize the heat transfer, not waste the heat, maximize the transfer through the wall of the crucible and into the metal as quickly and efficiently as possible. And we want that heat spread evenly over the face of the crucible. If you end up with crucible hot spots or crucible cold spots, as we'll get into this afternoon, that's not a good situation for the crucible. The crucible loves to be full and hot and evenly heated. Crucible manufacturers, of which we are one, are working very hard to maximize the thermal conductivity of the crucible material. Some of the materials that were in the crucible that made it strong and durable 20 years ago, you can't put in a crucible anymore. So the crucibles have to be made with newer and different composite materials that drive thermal conductivity without being unsafe for the environment. There are new device and processes for making crucibles to make them stronger, to make them more dense, to make them last longer, to make them more durable, to make them less susceptible to attack by humans or chemicals. Those are all advancements in the crucible world. And the coverings on the crucibles, what's called the glazes. Some of them are fired on, some of them are impregnated, but they're being developed to provide longer crucible service life and better energy transfer to the melt. So if you were to go and do some research because you wanted to buy a new furnace and you wanted to buy a fuel-fired furnace because that was the energy source of choice, you would find different furnaces that were available. Then we'll just pick a 1,000-pound capacity furnace from different manufacturers and their burner sizes and their melt rates. So those burner sizes and that melt rate transfers into different efficiencies. So the efficiencies are going up, but you can still buy a furnace that is a fairly low efficient furnace for a gas-fired melter. Still exists, still sold. So you got to do your homework a little bit. If you went to an electric furnace because that was your source of energy of choice, same thing is going on. Different furnace manufacturers have different efficiencies. We'll pick 1,200 pounds as your bath crucible size. Different power inputs, different melt rates, different efficiencies result. So again, do your homework. Make sure you're buying the most efficient. If you're choosing efficiency, as you're going to spend more money typically for the higher efficiency furnace, is that more money going to pay you back? Here's a comparison. The 1970s, we saw that first generation recuperative furnace and a 2008 model recuperative furnace. And that particular 1970s furnace was powering a 800-pound capacity crucible. It had a 15 therms or 1.5 million BTU burner. It took, in that application, which happened to be a dip-out equals recharge rate, so the crucible was maintained at a fairly full level. It took 3.05 or 305,000 BTUs to process 250 pounds. When it was holding with the lid closed, it took a quarter therm or 225,000 BTUs. Putting in a newer technology recuperative furnace with a 1,000-pound capacity crucible, 5.5 therms roughly, 1.3 therms consumed, 0.12 therms consumed to hold. That's energy efficiency driver. Another scenario, tilt furnace, gas-fired furnaces, 2009 versus 1960s, 13 therms burner versus a 7.5 therms burner. Gas cost at 0.76 per therm or $7.60 a million BTUs. 22¾ therms to melt that 600 pounds, 10 therms to melt 700 pounds in a newer furnace. And again, holding 3¼ therms versus 0.7 therms in the two different furnaces. So you can see the energy efficiency through the newer technology. Here's the old pit furnace that you saw. So they put in an electric furnace. They put in a furnace that had a 550-pound capacity crucible. They dropped their energy uses by a third. They kept the crucible hot 24/7. And they hold metal off shift so they don't have to bring somebody in 2 hours a day early to start melting. Again, what's best for your facility depends on what energy you're running. Depends on your infrastructure cost if you wanted to try and use a dual fuel furnace. Depends on what kind of metal quality you need for the castings you make for your customer. Depends on what kind of process you're running. What crucible is best for your operation? Get a hold of the crucible manufacturer that you use. Find out what's available. The crucible that you used 20 years ago may not be what you use today. It may not be the best choice for you, so find out.